Hi, everybody. Welcome back to the Inspire Health Podcast. And we continue on with our series on creating new earth, a collaborative mission. And today we're bringing back Kaya Usher. And if you didn't see our previous episode, Kaya and I met on the detox and cleanse series, and we had an awesome interview around frequency detox, and definitely one you'll want to check out. So I'll put a link for that in the show notes. We go through a lot of Kaya's background and how she even came to this specific type of work that she does. For just briefly, Kaya was married to Gord Downie, who is absolutely amazing, iconic musician with the Tragically Hip out here in Canada. And then when Gord had passed away and when Kaya had gone through some pretty major health challenges, she really stepped into understanding and harnessing the frequencies and how they play a role with shifting our lives, and then also how she can help others in the same way. She became the author of the Simplicity Platform, Harness the Power of Frequencies to Shift Your Life. She wrote a book on that, and she's doing music, and now you're doing music with your family. I mean, really amazing stuff. And so I wanted Kaya to be on this episode and this series particularly because we had a really beautiful conversation last time, and she's got a really, I think, a really clear picture too of where our potential is and where we can move. And that's really what this is all about. It's like, I want to talk to different people that can envision something new outside of the old. This is the trickiest part, I think, is that we're so patterned and conditioned to what we know that it's hard to envision something really new that's out of the box of what we have only known. And so this is part of this whole series, is let's shake it up a little bit. Let's talk about it from a different perspective. And how do we actually embody that and then manifest that here on the planet? So Kaya, thank you so much for being a guest on the show again.
Thank you for having me. And I'm so happy that you're both here this time. And the topic is really, like, I got really excited when we got the email with the invitation, because the topic is right up my alley. It's how I live. And so I'd love to talk about that today.
Yeah, I think this will be really great. So the last one we did was on frequency detox, and that goes through all of that sort of concept of how we really shed a lot of what we aren't and then embody what we are so that we can step into that. And I think sometimes that's a bit of a foundation for even creating this new earth. But yeah, tell me a little bit about your journey. I mean, we last spoke about a year ago, and at that time we were actually in Mexico and you were in Toronto and now we've switched. So now we're back in Canada and you're actually in Costa Rica. So maybe just give us a heads up on what's gone on since we last spoke.
Yeah. So it's funny how we've switched things around. So, you know, in every place you are in life, there's a tremendous opportunity. And for me in Toronto, you know, it was really challenging because it's like my heart was expanded into nature and just wanting to be, you know, I've always seen myself at the ocean. I've always seen myself with open skies and just pure nature. But here I was in Toronto with, you know, I have four children and just a lot of our life, my husband and I, like, took place there. But what I saw was that as I would walk around the city streets, I just started feeling less and less connected to that space. And I knew that a change was coming. But I also knew that there was no rush because I was using what I call heavier frequencies. So the heavier frequencies of the city, I was using that to actually really fine tune myself and get into a position, well, you know, how can you stay really, really clear and really positioned in, like, the present moment, even when your life maybe isn't exactly where you want to be? So I used that, knowing that it was going to take me a couple years to pack things up and get myself where, and I, you know, I wanted my son to be really comfortable with coming with me. So it was a bit of a waiting game. But then when he gave the nod, like, I'm ready, Mom, it was like, phew. You know, it was like back and out, like we went. But so, you know, where I am now, so I'm in Costa Rica now, and all I can say is that you don't know sometimes how bad something feels until you release, like, to get away from it. And what I found is that, you know, deep respect for Canada, deep respect for my family, my friends and everything. But for me, it was no longer a match. And I feel like I can do better work from here. I feel like my feet on the ground, my feet in the ocean, you know, walking wherever it might be in the jungle, I feel like my signal is going to be stronger here in Costa Rica to actually really help influence the planet and influence the people on the planet. So it was a conscious decision for me, but also for everybody, that I can do better work here.
Interesting. Kaya, when we moved to Mexico, we had a few things happening here on Vancouver Island. So we were originally in Ontario and 2020 hit, and we wanted to move back to the island. We had plans on moving back to the island since we were engaged, since I first met your family, since we first came on the island. I'm like,
it had been like a 10 or a 12 year.
Like, what are we doing in Ontario again? And so Jason was actually born on the island, so most of his family is around this area. So we did have plans to come here. And in 2020, we had worked a little bit in preparation for the move. When COVID hit, we were like, okay, it's time. And we made a trek across country on a U-Haul and brought my parents with us. But when things started to close down on the island to the point where they literally were telling us there's this section that you're of the island that you're supposed to stay in if you live here, and you're not allowed to go in this section. And, you know, this article came out in April of 2021, and it started to get implemented, or they started to talk more about it in August of 2021. And that's when I said, okay, I think it's time we look at other options. And again, we were getting pushed by a few things from here and getting called to go elsewhere. And Costa Rica was an option. It was always on our radar for a very long time. And our kids, literally, actually, 2 days before we ended up getting the tickets and flying out, the kids came out with their little backpacks all packed up and said, okay, we're ready to go to Costa Rica.
Without any talk about it.
Yeah. It was
wow. Really interesting.
And so with that, we were looking, we quickly actually looked at our options, and we know that you're able to stay for a longer period of time in Mexico than you are in Costa Rica with a visitor pass. So at that time, it made sense for us we decided to go to Mexico. And we did it within 2 days. We bought the tickets, packed for two nights, cleaned the house in case my parents wanted to rent it out, and we left. And after almost a year of being in Mexico, similar sort of scenario where it's like we started to walk on the streets, on the regular places where we would trek through in Mexico, and all of a sudden, like, the colors looked paler, and it was our time there felt done, felt complete. That was a feeling. So it's a really interesting thing. Even when people ask us, when family asks us, you know, can we book this trip, you know, 5 months from now to go and visit this spot together as a family? And we're looking at each other like, can't do it. Like, we don't even know what's going to happen, what we're going to be called to do in a week from now. So it's planning ahead, especially when it's months down the line, is not a realistic thing for us at all.
Well, it's something that I think ties probably with, I'm sure you've found too, Kaya, with the work you've done with the frequency work. It's as I feel like the more you want to be in tune with that, you have to, well, I shouldn't say you have to, but the more you want to be in tune with that, you start to create more and more untethering so that you can function faster, so that you can function more spontaneously. Because when you're called to do something, if you're tethered to so many things that makes it really difficult, you then just can't really honor it. This has sort of been a process for us, has been, where are all the ways that we've been untethering from systems in a way that are making it hard to live in the way that you're being called to live?
Yeah. I call it the backpack. You know, what do you like? Could you leave? Could you, you know, throw on a backpack and be comfortable? Like, I like to live like that all the time. Or, you know, with my kids, I'll say that when I'm driving, I love driving. And I said I could drive forever on this highway and not know where I'm going, because I'm here. you know, that idea that is, as long as you're embodied and you're present, we'll be provided for. It's that whole, we've lost the idea that, you know, when we're clicked in to ourselves, our mind, body, and spirit, we're really clicked in and tight, embodied, we will be provided for. So even though we don't necessarily know exactly our destination, or we don't have all the creature comforts that most people are comfortable with, that deep trust comes in. And so that's where I am now, where I just know if I stay focused, where my only focus is to really know myself, I will be provided for. And it's me that's going to provide for me. It's, you know, my connection with God or creator or source. It's me with that connection that's going to provide. So I'm there. And that's really what I like. I like to use myself and as an example of that, where I don't fuss anymore. You know, there was a time in life where, you know, I was running programs and I, you know, and we all do run programs to a certain extent, but you can get to a place where you've left most of the programs behind and you're fluid and you're just really flowing through the process. You know, the ultimate program is the program just with creation itself. And that's where, you know, that's where I see all of us going. And that's, you know, really to the topic today, is that creation is where we are now. If we're ready for that, it's waiting for us to fully take those action steps. So,
yeah. Kaya, have you always had that connection to source?
Yeah, I think so. So like, cause what happens is, so I think that everybody does. So we come and, you know, you guys have young children, and when we're young, we're all very connected. I do believe that, like, as babies, and, you know, we're able to see and we're able to know, and we're very intuitive. And lots of times we look at our parents and the messages we're sending them, they're not receiving. It's like they're, you know, they've closed down those gifts, which are very natural. They've closed that down. And the children are looking desperately for a way to communicate with, they want an open channel. You know, they want to be able to communicate, but the key is to be able to keep that open your whole life. And, you know, for me, I mostly kept that open. I would say that, you know, where I knew that. So I didn't really, you know, grow up with a spiritual family, and I didn't really, you know, I went to church with my great grandmother a little bit, and I always felt really, really special there, but it was more about just the way I felt and less about the teachings, if that makes sense. Like, I would just found that the music and just the stained glass and the sun coming through the window and just holding my grandmother's hand. And it was just more like that connection. I knew that we were all more, not that I was more, that we were all more. And, you know, when I met Gord, it was like, and I said this in the other podcast with you, I think, where I met someone who knew that a spark of an idea is tangible. If you have the spark of, you know, that, you know, I've got this great idea. I'm like, I met him and he talked the same way that I knew we existed. And it was like, oh my God, finally, mm-hmm. finally, you know, like someone that speaks my language, where it's like, let's go. And so we just started, like, you know, really riding that wave together. And we wanted to have a lot of kids together, and just our life took us in that direction where I really was that compass. You know, I stayed home because I was strong and I was confident, and I knew that that was a really important role as a mother, as that, you know, divine feminine woman. I wanted to stay home, hold that nurturing frequency while he went out into the world and, you know, did what he did. And then he would always come back, and, you know, he was that protective father and all of those things. So to answer your question, yes. Now, in my early 40s, I did go through a really hard time, but I think that's when I got sick, and that's when I went through my near-death experience. And I think that was, you know, all in position for me to really open up. So, like, I went down really far and fast into sort of that, you know, that dark night of the soul. But I believe that was instigated by me, so I could really open up, because it was time for me to really start helping at a different level. So my kids were older and all that stuff, you know?
Yeah. Kaya, I love when you said the spark of an idea is real. That in a lot of ways, I think, is at the heart of even this concept for this whole series. And how do you play with that? How do you build on that? Because it's this point where this is something we follow a lot of times, because it's like whenever we get that, to me, that's divine insight. As soon as you get that spark and you get super inspired, it's like you almost can't not do it. You have to kind of keep moving forward. But then
that's
inevitably,
how we operate this platform.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. And then inevitably, though, a lot of times you'll hit resistance, you'll hit different things around that. And I think a lot of times people then just kind of let it go. Yes. and then sort of let it go to the side and sort of then put themselves back into the familiar box of what's possible and
talk
whatnot.
Themselves out of it.
Yeah, it's easy to rationalize our way out of it. How do you nurture that and keep that going until you really actually create it into the world? I think that's a really important point to help to flesh out for people.
And it's a great question, because I've seen this in my own work, working with clients, and I see it all the time. And I've been doing this now for long enough, so for 5 years, that I have enough experience to really see what you're talking about. And so that spark, it's almost like the spark of an idea is the easy part, you know, because that, like, everybody has, like, you know, we all have these great ideas. So what I see happens after that is the importance of the follow through. You actually have to have, that's Blueberry waking up from her nap. So you have to have that action step. So the trust needs to come in where you're like, you start to really, so a lot of this, let's back up for a second, comes the more experience you have with the gains of when you have the follow through and you do the action step where you see that you're actually met. You're met with, wow, like the courage to push through and make the action, that phone call, or whether it's a move that you need to take or a connection you need to make or a discipline that you need to bring in or a deeper trust in yourself, whatever it is that follow through, that action step that needs to happen, the more you do that, the more momentum that starts rolling and you start rolling and flowing with it, because you keep getting confirmation every time I take an action step and I'm grounded, I trust, and I have the follow through, I get met by myself. It's like, whoa, it's like you get this natural like pat on the back by yourself, and your spirit, your higher self keeps going, you did it. So that courage starts building, that momentum starts building, that trust starts building, everything starts expanding for you. So you have to start by doing it. You know, it's not so many people that I know, and then that comes into, you know, frequency work, is that, like, this work to me is very, very powerful when people start to feel the higher frequencies of who they are. And the key is, don't stop there, because what'll happen most of the time, if you don't have the discipline and focus, you're going to drop back down. And you may just drop down a little bit. And I don't even like to use the word drop back down, because it's not really like that. But you may go into your old programs that you were running if you're not careful, because it actually takes a lot of discipline to start. It's like learning to do, you know, a skill set, and learning to do it really well, and then refining that. So you have to be able to say, no matter what. So for me, like, I use myself as examples. No matter what, I will not ever leave myself. I will never, ever, ever, ever leave myself and that connection that I've made, no matter if it hurts somebody in the end. Actually, I know that they will, at some point, if I stay in my truth, they will look back at it and they'll go, that's why she did that. Mm-hmm. They will understand at some point, that's why she did that. She actually was holding her sovereignty. She was holding integrity, and like, she was doing it. So even though we may, what seems like, be ruffling feathers around us, or maybe even hurting people because they don't understand, I won't leave myself. And so when other people, you know, perhaps these old programs are starting to come in, it's not my place to say, like, because at the beginning I used to hoist people out, and I'd say, no, don't do that. And I'd pull them back out of the programming and say, you know, you don't want to, you know, you're dipping back in now to all the stuff that you wanted to leave behind, you know, those addictions are coming back, or those, you know, that those abusive relationships or your health issues are coming back. But now what I've learned is that the best thing I can do is really lead by example. This is what I do. I hold the structure. And if you want to join and you're serious about really like creating this new space, which is here and waiting for us. It's already here. Let's run together. Let's hold hands and let's do this together. You're doing you, I'm doing me, but together we're building that momentum and growing like exponentially. The more of us together, the faster we can do this. So it's about the self. It's about trust, momentum, integrity, focus, building on the courage. And then over and over again, as you get knocked down, I use those. I get knocked down all the time. Things happen. Things are happening in Costa Rica right now all the time because it's a new country. Mm-hmm. Left, right, and center, my son and I look at each other like, oh my God, we didn't have water for the last. I was like, please let me be able to have a shower for this podcast. Because my friend said, no, ocean hair is beautiful. I said, this is not ocean hair. I do not have ocean hair. Like, I didn't have water for 2 days. I didn't have Wi-Fi for 2 days. It just came on like in the last few hours. So, you know, all those things that happened. But I trust. I knew that if this is meant to happen, I didn't fuss for a second, mm-hmm. you know, because that's where you get to, that you just know. That is, you're going to be provided for. And we're here, mm-hmm. you know, we're being provided for. And not in the way we think. Mm-hmm. That's the other thing.
Yeah.
But I don't have expectation in the way that I think we've been programmed to. We think if we get this amount of money or if this just comes in, if that, it's not like that.
God, it's often absolutely not like that. Like it's almost like what I find, this is like where it feels really magical at times. Mm-hmm. And also, we've mentioned this before, but it really comes down to a certain point of just really unconditional trust and faith in that you're being going to be held, right? And don't have an attachment to what you think that being held needs to look like, because it could be very different than what you think. But just this, oh, I mean, that's really at the heart of it. That's a surrender. And I think that's a really high level of consciousness to be able to truly surrender things over. And sort of, then I think you are in that flow, but then you've opened yourself up to an infinite number of ways that something could pop in, where when we're trying to control it, we keep a very small box of possibilities that we think are okay. And I think this is a process that we're all going through. It's like, can you be okay in the unknown? Can we practice that space of being a little bit more okay with not knowing exactly what things are going to look like?
Mm-hmm. And then you get that, you really, that's what you crave, is not knowing. You know, it gets very exciting. Like I wake up in the morning and I say, surprise me. Like I know that, like that's where that childlike wonder comes in, where you really, you know that, you know, it could be even better than you could even imagine. So when you stay open to that, there's no restriction to what could come in for you. Mm-hmm. So.
I think when we talked in the series we did on the, with all the near-death experiencers on the life, death, and beyond, exploring our greater reality, we talked to someone named Nancy Dannison, who has written a number of books, and she's crossed over and really had quite profound experiences in remembering what was coming back. And that was one thing that she actually talked to about why we are here at this. We crave the not knowing, even though it scares us, but that's a part of the excitement of everything. It's the wonder. It's the wonder of not actually knowing.
That's what I was going to ask you. Did fear play a part in your journey? Like as you're, you know, deciding to move and you're packing everything and you're moving from one country to another without, I'm not sure if you speak the language, but it's on foreign land. Mm-hmm. So was fear a factor there?
So it wasn't for this particular move. And you're right. Like, I mean, I'm learning to use Google Translate, but I am committed to learning Spanish. So that is something that I really want to learn, but I didn't have fear for this move. But if we go back to when I had my near death experience and when I got sick, I experienced very deep fear at that point. It was like a death. It was like a death of, I almost died as I was, I had an emergency surgery after my initial surgery for my breast cancer. And a couple hours later, I started hemorrhaging and I went into an emergency surgery. And at that point, that's when I actually had a near-death experience where I came back and I was really opened up at that point. And the fear was just, I saw the world. It's almost like I transcended the, what, you know, what some people call the matrix. And I'd gone beyond that space. So I could see clearly that death was not something to fear. And so it was at that point that I realized, oh, it's now time to start living. So I had to go through that. And so, yeah, it was really like a really, really challenging. It was fast and furious what I went through. And Gord was alive at that point. And, you know, he sort of watched me go through that. And it was really hard because, you know, with that, you want to be alone because you don't want to burden people. And yet everyone's watching you go through that sort of true crisis, crisis of identity, but it's a death actually. So you can truly live. And so I would say that that's when I released the fear. So now, like, I really don't have that fear anymore. Like, if I'm really being truthful, it's like, I could have, like, for example, like we jumped off a waterfall the other day. So I had that kind of like joyful fear. Like it was that's a good fear because it's like, don't kill yourself, Kaya. That's that kind of fear. But like the idea that like what could go wrong, or, you know, what if you're making a bad decision? There are no bad decisions. Like there are no bad decisions. So if I'd chosen a different country, there's something there that I would have learned about myself there too. So like you get into a place where you're just experiencing, and it's what you talked about, what this woman talked about with, you know, writing about near death and everything. It's like, we're just here to experience and we're just here to make choices. There really are no bad or good choices. It's about refining ourselves and really getting to know ourselves. So depending on where we put ourselves, I put myself here in Costa Rica right now, because this is where I want to get to know myself. This is where I want to experience my frequency connection with nature here. But there, like, it's really important for everybody in your audience that's listening, is like where you are right now is very workable. You know, so a lot of people feel like, oh my gosh, like I'm never going to get to the place I'm meant to be. Wherever you are right now is where you start to work from. And you'll see that, like, if you're willing to really feel yourself in that exact surrounding, whether you're sitting in a room and it feels like really closed off and you're feeling closed off, feel that, like be that, be right there. That's your best chance of breaking free from that space. If you've always had a vision of, like me, like being in an ocean, riding a horse on the ocean, I've always had that vision since I was a little girl. But I also, it's, if I was in a room by myself for the rest of my life, I know that I could make a life for myself there. I could make that work for me. So it's not about where you are. It's about what you're running in your internal world and who you've become in a relationship with yourself. It's about that connection. But by having that connection, you're never going to be locked in a room forever. That's never going to happen, because you're astounding. You're a creator. How could you possibly be locked in a room? But it's just, what I'm saying is that you use that opportunity to go deep, you know, and just really be aware of everything that isn't you. And that's how you're going to create yourself. And that's how you're going to create the world that you want to see in front of you and all around you.
I think that's so timely for what's going on right now, because I think, like, when you're talking about, you know, even if you were going to be in a box, and could you actually be there? Because I think what is happening, but in the reality is, like, if you're embodying that space, you'll likely never end up in that situation anyways. So I look at what's going on in sort of this sort of larger global perspective. And like here in British Columbia, they just passed this, or they actually in Canada, they just passed this Bill C-47, right? Where they're looking at really significantly breaking things down as far as regulating and making it very hard. And it does sound like it could be very devastating for the natural health industry. But at the same time, within that, if you don't totally get caught up in, that's the world that I'm going to be living in, and how do I have to work then within this world of more and more limitations, what we're starting to find is, like, when you're not holding that space, then these actual different possibilities are starting to pop in. So by not getting caught up in focusing here, but kind of like, okay, that's not the world I'm living in. That's not acceptable. That's not an infinite being to live in a world that likes that. It doesn't make any sense. So you kind of focus more on what you're wanting. And then all of a sudden it's like, click, click, click. These different possibilities are popping in that are really potentially exciting to actually create even more freedom than what we currently had, you know? And this is what I think is going to start to happen is pushing then to blossom something really new and even bigger than what you could have expected. And so this is kind of the path we've been on over the last while with this. It's like, as soon as this stuff started to happen and you sort of become aware of it and you feel this sort of trying to close down, but if you don't want to live in that world, remember what you want it to be like and what you want it to feel like. And then that starts to surface. It's like, and there's other people wanting that too. And all of a sudden you connect with those different people. And I mean, I think it's really exciting. It's like this crucible that tightens, but in that process, you know, you become more of that diamond.
It's exactly what you were talking about being in Toronto. And when you said you were actually working with those denser frequencies and trying to really figure out then how it was affecting you and how you wanted to then alter your reality as a result. But I feel like the time that we're in right now, if we can just see it as a catalyst to really allow our inner light to shine through in ways that it hasn't had before, then what does that look like? Like, who do you want to be? How do you want to function? How do you want to operate? How do you want to live? And just start contemplating these questions, and it'll start to, like Jay said, open up lots of different pathways and opportunities and people showing up. And it can lead you from a place where you couldn't have even fathomed is how we're finding it. It's like we can't really actually plan for these things because our intellectual planning is always based on where we've been. It's always based on the past. Mm-hmm. And I feel like where we're moving to is so much bigger than that, so much more vast than that, with so many more possibilities.
This is exactly, what if we are the frequency technology? What if we can transcend, we don't need supplements? What if we can transcend everything in that we are running such a brilliant frequency that generates that, let food, let sun, let water, let communion, let community, could we transcend the need for, like, maybe that's what's happening here, is that we're expanding so much that we realize that, you know, there's talk about these med bands, there are all these ways of biohacking and all these things, like there's like frequency, like things that you attach to your body and all these different things. What if we realize that we actually are the technology. We already are the technology. And so if we could clarify to such a degree and get our frequency running so gorgeously in that bandwidth, we actually don't need any of those things. Like, I've left all the systems. I'm not part of any systems anymore. Like, you name a system, I'm not doing it. I'm not doing the systems. Like, all those ones that, you know, like, I'm now using. And this is where I saw, like, you know, humans in the past, we were very sophisticated. You know, it's not the history that we were told. We were very sophisticated. We used the sun. We used the water. We used food. We used beautiful, fire. We used land. We used everything that we created here on this earth. We used it to keep our frequency bandwidth really pristine. And we've gotten so deeply into these places where we think we need all these things. So perhaps this is an opportunity for us to say, you know what, when something is taken away, say it is taken away, maybe there's something even better behind that next door. And that's what I'm seeing here. It's like, so there's an opportunity for us here. There's an opportunity to drop even the need for anything beyond, because I feel better than I felt my entire life. Why is that? I'm out of all the systems. Mm-hmm. So how is that? I'm free.
I think it's really fascinating. And I mean, so many things coming up when you're talking about that. Absolutely. I think frequency vibration, energy-based magnetics, this area is, I think, where health is moving anyways. I think that is, that actually oversees the chemistry and the biology and everything else. So we can do that, I think, on our own. And I think we are going to hopefully even see some of these different technologies. And I mean, if people haven't seen it, listen to the episode prior with Ralph Sudeth. I mean, he's literally like a Tesla genius that's here right now. And he talks about frequency. We've had a deep conversation around water and the frequency mm-hmm. of water and the memory in water and how all of these things play into it. And if we can clean up some of those things and get exposed back to the original purity that's in them, that has an effect on every single cell in our bodies. You know, it's really quite astounding. And all of these other technologies are starting to come out that are working on that layer with frequency based types of healing.
And you're right, exactly. I feel like even when you're saying we are able to do that, we are that, I feel like that's absolutely true. And as far as those of us who have been immune to the programming that's been going on for especially the past few years, I feel like it's because what's anchored us is, you know, the connection to nature, the meditation, the constant turning into, well, who am I? What am I? You know, how do I serve? Those sort of questions that Paul Selig dives into as well. But if we're able to stay on that trajectory, then I feel like we are, like you said, that technology. We are received, we have that direct connection to source, and that cleansing and clearing is happening on a regular basis because we are of that. So anything that is inhospitable within this environment that is not conducive to even holding that is constantly cleared out.
The higher frequency always wins. It's just that simple. So when you transcend, you know, this time space, what some people call the matrix, when you transcend that, you're getting into that God frequency. And that frequency is much higher than all the control in the world. So when you transcend that, nothing, like, it's just, yes, you can see it and feel it and know it and all of that, but the higher frequency burns away the lower frequencies. And if water can do it, if water can change, you know, then so can our blood and so can our chemistry. So can every single thing, you know, in our infrastructure. It's the same thing. It's the same thing. It's just that because we think, you know, and we, you know, you see animals in nature, they're just naturally doing it all the time. They're constantly just, you know, they're creating that vortex and they're spinning and they're cleansing themselves at all times. And so are we too, but it's us that we interject. We're the ones that are, you know, ramming the spokes in and stopping ourselves from being able to be fully running at our frequency bandwidth that we're naturally meant to be. So just like the water, you know, that pristine, beautiful, loving water that your previous guest, which I can't wait. I'm going to listen to that. I'm going to listen to all the episodes, but I saw that and I thought, like, that's right up my alley, because it's true. We're the same.
Yeah. Oh, well, and the other thing that I think is coming up with all of this too, is it's changing our relationships with I think source and with nature. So for me, it's like, I mean, I've been a naturopath for over 20 years and I worked a lot with herbs and I've worked a lot with supplements and all this kind of stuff, but it's been through a couple of filters, because, you know, it's like I'll order a product and I'll come in, I know what they're all used for, but I'm not connected to the plant. Since we've been out here, what's been really amazing is I've been learning more about the actual plants. I've been taking my kids with me. So my 7-year-old particularly has a real affinity for it. So we'll go and we will wildcraft and harvest plants, and we'll do it with a sacredness, and we will make tinctures with them. We'll make teas with them. We drink them. So, and I can see this exciting remembering coming up in her, you know, it's like, oh, daddy, that one's this, and that's good for this or this or this.
It's almost like she's becoming activated. There's something within her that's kind of lighting up.
So it's like, what's happening is it's re-sparking the sacredness that I'm seeing in nature. And now that's a part of the medicine that we're making and that we're taking when we choose to take it or have the tea. So it's like, to me, that's all of a major shift in frequency. Now that's being all embodied because of the genuine love and gratitude for these plants is all inherent within the process of it. And so there's, and for some people, they might say, ah, plants are plants, whatever. It's like,
or
it's,
we,
it's
and
just
we used to
different.
Call them weeds.
Yeah.
You know?
Most of these are weeds you want to get rid of. And you're like, oh my gosh, like, I don't know if you've ever seen, if you've ever seen milk thistle, but it's like, it's not a comfortable looking plant, but it's so beneficial. And you start to have this reverence for these things. So it's like, if you can do that with plants, then maybe we can start to have that same mentality with other things in our lives that we once viewed in a certain perspective that was negative. And now we can start to see it from a light of value.
Sacredness.
And that's the beauty. Like, I think about your daughter, and what I'm seeing is, by her, the purity of her intention and her touching these plants, these herbs, they actually become more powerful. They become like, so, and you foraging them yourself, your intention and the purity of, you know, you being with your daughter, those will be a higher frequency, and they will help your clients in a way, as opposed to, you know, someone packing them that doesn't really care. They're throwing them in the bottle. It's about the person. The intention of the person and their frequency and sharing the communion. So like your daughter, she could be a beautiful healer by touching that. Like, it's just, it's not about what you've done and any kind of like certificate on a wall. It's who are you at frequency level and what is your intention? And then that's the gift of giving, you know, that's the true gift of giving. So that is just beautiful. And that's really, you know, the topic of this podcast is that's where we're going. You know, it's that pure intention where it's not about age. It's not about level. It's not about status. It's not about any of that. It's about, you know, who are you inside? What are you? Where is your heart in all of this? You know, is it open and expansive? Is it childlike? Is it connected? And guess what? What you share could touch a million people. The innocence of a child could touch a million people by her frequency. So,
Kaya, Paul Selig, who's going to be within the series as well, his newest book that's going to be available for the public is called Innocence. And it's really a return to the innocence, a return to the sense of wonder and curiosity. And it's these qualities that I feel like we've been embodying more and more, and you've been just by the description of your journey have been embodying more and more as well. It's like stepping into the unknown through that innocence, through that trust. And what are we trusting? It's that connection to source, that we are the fractal of God, that person or that force that we've been waiting for is right here. And if we can just step into that inner knowing with more tenderness and more curiosity, what would that look like? And when you're speaking of having faced the ultimate fear, which is the fear of death, did you find that then by doing so that started to diminish the other fears that come up on a daily basis?
Absolutely. When you remember who you are in your highest, so your higher self, and you have that deep remembering. So for me, I started seeing all my other lifetimes. I started seeing, you know, you go through that near death experience and you see through the eyes of love. Then you start understanding there was never anything to fear. So every choice that I make now, I want to live. Every choice I make is about life and living now, because even by doing that, your death will never be of suffering anymore, because you would never suffer in a death once you know who you are in your highest. Like, you'll just decide to, you know, in a moment, whether it's you fall asleep, or I always say to my son, I'm just going to walk into the ocean and I'm just going to wave goodbye. And I'll just like, just go. The ultimate would be for me to get on the back of a whale and just ride out like that. But you know, what happens is you're not afraid. And so all the other fears, they fall away too, because you're too busy living. You're too busy in that innocence. And, you know, to me, the innocence, it's the breadth of also knowing. In that innocence, it's knowing all the possibilities, which there are many that aren't pleasant. You know, what I went through, that dark night of the soul, an innocence comes in through that darkness. So it's not like to say that everything is just positive and everything is great. No, it's being able to hold the breadth of it all. You know, that the weight of like what could be and what could have been. So holding the weight of it all for our brothers and sisters of the world, and being very aware of all the trajectories there are and all the different choices there are. But the innocence of still choosing the ultimate connection, like that is it's an innocent choice. And it to me is, you know, where we're all heading. So it's not like we're all heading there in our own time frame. But you know, many of us are just, we're making choices right now that are still perhaps, you know, they're learning curves for us. Many people are making choices right now, which I did, which we all do, that are hard choices that maybe are putting us in a position where it's getting harder and harder and harder. But could you use that as a, you know, as a catapult, as a trajectory to, you know, to transcend it all? Like, so to me, innocence is every choice, and knowing what you're going to choose. You're going to choose the highest choice, the most refined choice for yourself. And there's no fear in that space. It just can't be. So yes, the death for me opened up a space where I chose life. It's just like I've chosen to live now. So even in my death, I see that as life too. I don't see that as a death anymore. I see that as another form of life, that all, when I'm ready, I'm going to experience that as well.
Yeah. I think with the innocence too, it's like, when you think about it, it's innocence is pre any other programming. So it's before mm-hmm. any of that stuff. So then the natural choice is going to be the one that is connected to source, because that is what's there when you're operating from that place of pure innocence. It's like, you're not, anything that's not you is not really there, right?
It's the origination. You're right. In the origination, there's none of this.
Yeah.
There's none of that. What would hold you back? It just doesn't exist. So you're back to that. That's right.
You were saying something earlier that I think was really important. It reminded me of an experience I had, but you were talking about when you were just showing up as who you were, and that sometimes that would actually maybe even offend other people or hurt them in a certain way. Or I shouldn't say hurt them, but they might feel hurt from the interaction. And, you know, I was sitting the other day, and we sit down, and I usually go in the morning, I'll sit down in the garden for a little while with the chickens walking around. And that's kind of like my, as our kids say in their forest school, my sit spot. And I'll sit there for a little while and meditate and just be still. And then the question popped up of, what do I hide from the world? And as I was contemplating that a little bit, the first things that popped up were things like, you know, my weaknesses, like to be embarrassed or to do something that would be perceived as foolish or to make others uncomfortable or make them uneasy or me uneasy. And then it kind of dawned on me that that's not actually what I hide from the world. What I hide from the world is actually more my strength. It's more the dragon self that actually comes up to be completely who you are, that then might cause that reaction sometimes, but it's not coming from a place of weakness. It's actually stemming from a place of strength. So that was something that was really profound for me to, and it was like, I mean, I knew it to be so true in that moment. I could feel it so strongly. And then it was almost like, okay, well, then what? What does that mean to fully act and be in that place and live my life from that place of real, true authenticity of who you are, even if that makes other people uncomfortable? But like you said earlier, it's not coming from a place to make people uncomfortable. It's, if your truth makes somebody else uncomfortable, that's going to be all part of a bigger picture anyways. And how do you want to operate in the world, and what's going to change to live like that?
Well, and I, like my son and I were just talking about that at dinner the other night. It's, your best chance is to be 100% yourself all the way home, to be yourself, because you're going to connect with the people who love that, you know? So it's like, why would you want to try to be anything less than who you are? Because you're going to collect experiences that aren't a fit. They're not a fit for you. So it's like, you can do this in a way that, like, I know I might not make sense to everyone, and I might even scare some people, because it's like, when you're authentic and you're sovereign and you're free, what it can do sometimes is it can turn up for other people their weak spots, and it can make people uncomfortable. But I know the greatest thing that I can do is to keep going, because that's my best chance. It's the best thing for me, but it's the best chance for, you know, our communities and for the world. It's like, we've all dimmed ourselves down so much, but look at where it got us, right? So my son and I, he's into fashion design, and he's, you know, doing all this great stuff. And what I realize is that, you know, the best thing that we can do is be 100% ourselves. That's it. So, you know, that's a learning curve. That was a learning curve for me. I kind of was always like that. Gordon and I would joke that I don't have a shy gene. I really don't have a shy gene. I was born without one. So like from when I was really little, it's like, there's a talent show. Great. I'm in. Like everything was just very natural for me to just do it. I wasn't shy about that. But I think that I knew that that is how I was going to find the friends that I wanted to find, and how I was going to find the partner, you know, and how I was going to do the work that I wanted to do. So it's just a fast track when you can just drop all your fears and just start really just going for it and being courageous in that space. It's a fast track for you to start really just that flow comes in. It's like what was a trickle was a river, and then it becomes the ocean. You know, it really does become that much for you when you just start, like, I don't care. It's like what I said at the beginning was, I won't budge. I'm really stubborn. I'm not going to leave my structure. I'm never going to leave this structure again. And so many people, you know, it's like just a little bit, you give a little bit of yourself away, a little bit. And that's really why I got sick. I just kept giving little bits of myself away to help. Mm-hmm. And all of a sudden it was like, oh, I was just so depleted. And I was like, that doesn't work. That way doesn't work. The way it works is if we start running our own frequency technology. And, you know, so that's what I teach. And that's what, you know, my book is about, the 8 tenets. All of that is about teaching, how do I become my own frequency technology? And it's not hard. It's actually a remembering. It's already there within you. It's nothing you have to learn outside of yourself. It's something that's already in you that you have to reactivate, you know, and then you have to stick with it. You just have to stick with it. And you, before you know it, what we talked about, it's like that momentum builds, and then all of a sudden you're the ocean. So
I think that resonates, your message right there resonates for a lot of women, a lot of females out there, because mm-hmm. I think that's what we typically tend to do, just give, and then you feel just depleted and empty and overwhelmed at everything that comes at you, because you just don't have any juice left in you. And it's like, okay, what do you do now? And I think maybe even men go through it, but in a different way, maybe working. So they give themselves to the work. And then once they retire, it's like, oh, what now? What am I now? Can I ask maybe if you can share a couple of your tenets that you're speaking of in your book?
Yeah, so the first one, the most important, I'll share the first and the last. They're all important, but the middle part is the different stages of getting into but the first one is clean up your space. And so that it's releasing the programming. It's literally releasing all the programming, all the lies that we're never who we are. So what we told ourselves, what our lineage, all the constructs that we, you know, and there's millions of them, there's millions of constructs that we have running and before. So we run that, you know, we do it this way. This is our tradition. And we start running that construct, that program. And then the school comes in and we, you know, we have to sit at your desk, Johnny, and you have to behave and pay attention. We start running that program, all these programming. So clean up your spaces, releasing the programming. And what I find is, like I said, when the higher frequency overrides the lower frequency, so I come in like a tuning fork, I hit that high frequency, and all of a sudden the programs just start falling away for the person. And they'll say, I feel so calm, and I feel like myself, and like there's nothing to worry about. It's just all of a sudden, there's just no, what was I worried about? What was I thinking? Because they're in a higher frequency. And then the last one is, I want to get it Exactly. Sorry, Blueberry. Sorry, Blueberry. She was sitting on the book.
Blueberry is holding herself in the background right there.
Exactly. She loves it. Embody the lightness of being. And so what is that? So that's like literally being the ocean. So when you've rediscovered that you are creation itself, like when you become, you start running with the frequency of creation or God or creator or source, whatever, you know, works for you. It doesn't really matter. It's the same frequency. When you start embodying that, you're home. And that's just, so you have to clean up your space, and then you have to, you know, work with that momentum, what we were talking about, that trust, that discernment, that the courage, the authenticity, the letting go of the ego, the death, all of that stuff. And then you get to embodying the lightness of being, where you just, you become one. You become one with creation, where you really become, that's what true manifestation is. You just, you know, if you're holding that present moment, then it's like a thought can start generating. That thought can really start generating into form from that embodying the lightness of being. So I'm always amazed, like really quickly, things, if something's not right for me, if it's not safe or it's the wrong direction, it will literally get slammed down. It won't happen for me. And I'll really quickly get put on, you need to do this. And so I don't fight any of that. I just really accept that. I know that it's me that has my back in this space now. And so when I say that, that's there for all of us. It's like, we are all natural creators. And when we start to embody that lightness of being, then we'll see that that's what manifestation is. It's not a board. It's not, you know, wishing for something. It's, you get so clear in yourself that you become like the ocean of creation, where you just, everything's there. Everything is sitting there for you. And then you just, it becomes a desire for, you know, what we want to experience in the physical. It's like, this is a beautiful space. If we know how to work it, it's a beautiful space to experience, like the taste of food, you know, what we see with our eyes, the beautiful colors, the spectrum, like what I find in that embody the lightness of being, the spectrum and the color, the vivid colors, everything gets more vivid, like the taste of food, the touch, you know, when someone says something, the depth of what their words say, how deep it can go inside of you, and even painful stuff. Like, I think I feel pain more deeply now. I feel a lot of pain, but I don't hide from the pain. I want to feel the pain. So it's not about, you know, it's not about just the good. It's about everything and being able to just really be it all and be it in the moment, and then let it go. And then you let it go.
Beautiful. That's beautiful, Kaya. And I love that you even touched on that, because I think a lot of times people do think it's, we just move into this world of being happy and joyous all the time. And it's like, I mean, there's that you'd get bored, I think, if that was the case. And I think you'd stump your growth to a certain point. But to me, it's the same idea. It's the full embodiment of what you feel, and feel it deeply. You know, I think we did this was a conversation with like Frederick Lowen a long time back, who was the child of Alexander Lowen, who did the biodynamic work. And I think he was talking about how we just don't feel enough. You know, on the realm of like what's really good, we only feel up to here. And on the realm of what's really bad, we only feel up to here. And he goes, when you start to be able to experience more here, you also experience more here. It's like the whole bandwidth opens up. So you have a much deeper, rich experience of all of it. But it's not ruminated on, and it's not, I think, like you said, it comes and then it goes. I remember even reading, gosh, this was like Dan Millman book, I think Way of the Peaceful Warrior. And I think he did one story in there, and it was one of his teachers. And he was this amazing chef, and he had this restaurant, and his restaurant had burnt down. And he saw him, and he was just like beside himself, like so. And then it said within about a minute and a half, I think it said, it was like, okay,
yeah,
on, and it was done. And it was like, you know, and it's really, it's like, it sounds almost like, oh my gosh. And I'm sure there's,
well, you see kids processing emotions.
Yes,
this way.
That's probably the clearest you get mm-hmm. to is when you see kids have a massive meltdown, flipping out, and then it's done. And they're done, and they really are done.
And
meanwhile, the parents
recovering.
Are still sitting there, like, "Holy shit! Like, I'm not sure if I can come back quite yet." You know, you're still reeling through the pieces of it, but you can see how organically fast things can shift from being so intense to being gone. But you know, part of that, I think, that ties in with doing this sort of work of releasing patterns, because those are the things that usually get us stuck and caught back in these cycles.
And also, as parents, I find that. Oftentimes, like my mom would say, you know, don't let her be sad, just give this to her. I'm like,
we stump the process.
Mom, it's okay, just let her feel it, and then it'll just move through. I'm here for her, I'm not going anywhere, I'm not gonna abandon her, but just let her experience the feelings. Or, you know, my son, who's older, he's 18, and if he has any trials or tribulations, I want him to always know that he's loved, he's supported, but there's nothing wrong with challenges as they come up. They're ultimately lessons. So how is he working through them? Is he able to maintain a sense of clarity and calm? If he loses his temper, great, do that. Let that energy move through, but don't make, you know, rash decisions from that place. Come back to a place of calm and then figure out what your options are. But it's these, I feel like oftentimes as parents too, we, you know, out of the kindness of our heart, we don't want to see the kids suffering, so we want to make things better for them. But then we deprive them of the experience that ultimately is going to land there as true wisdom for them.
Exactly. And we're meant to, you know, I think about the experience we went through with loss of a death in our family with my kids and losing their father. I never wanted to take away that pain, because or try to band-aid it or anything. It's like we just sat in it, you know. And I found that was and they all processed differently, but everyone moved through it, because there was, you know, I really had to sort of put almost like a shield around the kids so they could actually do it the way that was very natural, which wasn't going to stunt that they were, you know, in 20 years going to have to process it. It's like, let's feel it all right now, you know, what tragedy feels like, what the pain of loss feels like. And, you know, and we do all do that differently, but as a parent, we're never meant to fix. We're meant to hold the space for our children. You know, we just hold. And set examples. Like so for me, my best way to parenting is just by me setting an example for my kids. This is someone who like has integrity, and when she does things, you know, she's holding that integrity, as opposed to, so I don't talk to my kids about what I do. I show them through example, and I never tell them what to do, because, you know, life is all about choices, and they'll see very quickly the choices they make, how they feel, and so I hold the space as they make those choices. And it's like, I didn't feel very good, you know, and then they'll very quickly self-correct. So, you know, I think as a society, we've tried to fix things to such a degree that we have lost so much there, that we have become so efficient that we don't know how to do anything or process anything anymore. And so now we're going back to like fully, we're not processing through our head, we're processing through our heart. Now, you know, I'm looking at your Mandela there. It's like that literally is the processing station. We process through our heart space, and things move really quickly when we do it that way. So, you know, allowing people to be individuals, to experience, you know, from their choices, what that is, there really are no good or bad choices, but you are going to have the repercussions. And that's where you're going to have to fine tune yourself. So whether you're a child or an adult or an elderly person, you know, I'm kind of tough in the way that, like, old people and young people, I treat everybody the same. It's like, we're all spirits. We're all capable. We're all equally gifted. And so, you know, I tend to not coddle, because I see people through spirit eyes. It's like, you know, old people, they can sometimes become, you know, victims. Like, I'm old. It's like, well, are you choosing to be old? Is that what you're choosing? Because I'm not going to choose to be that way. You know, that's going to be up to you how you want to go. If you want to start bending over and, you know, like, and that might sound really strange to people, but it's really, it's a loving statement. And to me, children are so gifted and they're very mature and they're very wise. So I never dumb it down for children either. It's like, I just stay the same for everybody because everybody to me is equal. We all have the ability to change no matter what family we were born into. You know, I was with a friend for dinner the other night, terribly abusive family he grew up in, horrible stories. But God, he turned his life around. He's brilliant. He's a brilliant human being. So no, it's not about your story. It's about, do you want to reconnect with yourself in that highest rendition? Because it's there for you. It's already there and running. It's already there. So, you know, many people, they're not ready, and there's nothing wrong with that. But for those who are ready, you know, that's where I'm going. You know, that's where I want to build that. I want to build that with people who want to build what's already in existence. I want to build out from that blueprint, you know, the blueprint of you in your highest, the blueprint of the earth in its highest, and coming together and really striking a really, an incredible opportunity for our children and their children and down the line and down the line. So they will hear of a time where, God, it got crazy. It got crazy. Wow. What a crazy time, but what an opportunity, you know, what an opportunity. And you guys are really doing this with this podcast. You see the opportunity in this moment, and they're just waiting there for us right now. So it's about having the action and be willing to, you know, get clear enough. You have to be clear enough that you can get the momentum. If you're not clear enough, it's hard to be focused. It's hard to be disciplined. It's hard to, you know, be authentic. If you're still weighted down with the programming, you got to clarify yourself first so that focus can come in. Without clarifying, it's going to be really hard. You're going to feel like, you know, you're not going to understand a lot. So you got to get clear enough, which is what I do, which is what I teach. And many people do it. I mean, you can do it by standing in the ocean. I do it by standing in the ocean. I get really clear standing in the ocean. So you can do it in any way. I just think what I do is just a really, it's loving and it's fun because there's a community there of people who are like-minded. And it's kind of cool because you don't need the ocean. You don't need any of it. You just need yourself. And I really like that because it just shows you the power really is within you. So...
Beautiful.
Mm-hmm. Kaya, can you tell us a little bit about some of the music that you're doing? We were listening to some earlier this morning, but I'd love to hear some of the work that you're doing because you're also doing this with the family band now too. So,
yeah, so I did. So the first record I put out is Kaya Usher and the Family Band, and that's what you listen to. Heart Clicks is one of the songs. And I did that at the beginning of the lockdown and everything. I went into Gord's studio, which he has in Ontario. And I brought some of the kids, not all the kids, some of the kids that were around. And we just went in. My best friend came. One of my good friends, Kevin, who's like a producer and in a band, he produced it. And we had so much fun. And, you know, I slept in Gord's bedroom and the sun would just come in. And it was like, I'd go to bed at night and have no idea what I was going to sing or what I was going to do. And in the morning, it would just all come in. And it literally was, nothing was planned. Like nothing was planned. And it was just all frequencies. And I think it's really beautiful. And I call it high frequency music because it like, what I hear from people is their kids and their animals really love it. It's a match for them. They feel really relaxed when they listen to it. And I did a lullaby album after that, about 6 months after that. And that was my oldest son and I, he played piano and Kevin, my friend played. So he and Kevin played piano. And then I just did a bunch of harmonies. I kept bringing in different harmonies and just increasing the frequency. And then we just recorded it. So it's a great way for people. I call it the lullaby series. And it's a great way to really, like women say, you know, if they're not sleeping well or whatever, that they tends to put them back to sleep. So, you know, it's great if you don't want to listen to a meditation or, you know, you're leaving your pets at home or your kids are running around or they're feeling off, you put it on and they don't even really know that what's happening. It's just a great feel good space. And I really enjoyed doing it. Like for me, it was really like using our voice and just releasing in that way is really a really great way for all of us. Like I would encourage that for everybody to use your voice and to sing and hum, and it will allow you to come even closer into who you are, because you're getting that sound feedback from yourself. And it's like a really great way to connect with your spirit. And it's not about having a good voice. It's about connection, like really getting familiar with yourself. So, you know, there are no bad singers. There are no, it's like about what I find is that you'll see that even that, the more you do that, you actually would come into to tune, the clearer you become. So.
I love it. We're going to actually play one of the tracks that you recommend for us at the end of this podcast episode. I did want to ask you, Kaya, what is the world that you're envisioning? Because I know you're at the leading edge of it and starting to live from that frequency right now. Where do you see all of us moving?
So it's back to how sophisticated we are in our original, like the original human. We are so sophisticated and we are so gifted. We are naturally able to see, hear, know, connect without words, all of that. Like we could just be sitting here and holding space in silence together and that communion would be happening. So really coming back into our sophistication and refinement, it's about timelines. And to me, so the new earth is already here. It's already in that high timeline, that perfect, you know, brilliant timeline. And so it's about us coming back into frequency brilliance, where we can be in that higher timeline, where we're a match with the planet in its highest. And so we'll come together as those sophisticated humans, or I call them organic humans, where we share. I don't even see money. I don't see money. I see sharing, communion, where, hey, I've got this gift. Like I'm a teacher. Could I help you with this? And you say, you know what? That's so funny. I have these chickens. You want a couple eggs? And I'm like, I love eggs. I love eggs. Or, you know, whatever it might be. And our children, where we're with our elders again, and we're sharing in the home. We're like, we're not separating ourselves anymore. We're not going into institutions where someone has to be separate and alone. We're together in communion, and we're in the highest, where, you know, animals, we pray over them again. We treat them with deep respect as they give us nourishment. You know, the water is naturally clean. Everything is in the highest. And so everything is in its original sophistication, which is, again, that innocence. It, you know, in the sophistication is the innocence, but is that authenticity, is the play, is the fun, and we're pure creation. You have an idea and I say, let's go, let's do it. If it's something that, you know, feels like fun and it's a match, then you go and you actually do it in that moment. There's no more waiting, because we're true manifestors. We're just creating again. So, you know, our children are our teachers. The elderly are our teachers. We become free again and out of the restricted, like the people that are sort of in the middle stages of life, we're no longer running through programs. We're all free again to be in pure connection. And we'll see that animals want to be around us. Nature naturally is always clear and clean and in its highest. And, you know, we won't need very much. That's the other thing. We won't need very much. But if we need it, it will be there for us. That's the thing. It's not about having to give up anything. We won't need much because we're so sophisticated in what we're able to create. But if we need something, it will be there for us in that time that we need it.
Mm-hmm. I love it. You know, yes, last night we were listening to a purification track from someone that we've listened to for the last several years, Jacqueline Hobbs, who has a site called oraclegirl.org. Really beautiful work. And we'll actually be depending on when this one is released, we'll be doing actually a talk on her platform with
August 11th.
Her August 11th.
Great.
It's going to be really fascinating. It'll be really beautiful. I'm not going to spill it yet because we'll tell you more about that, but it's going to be really, really good. And if you haven't seen her work, it's pretty amazing too. But she just did a track where she was talking about money. Mm-hmm. And it's this idea that money is not first, money is second. Like, first is the bonds of affection between people and based on a currency of care. And it's like, if that's the foundation, then there can be lots of different ways to work out
the transactions.
Those transactions that take place, but it's based on first comes bonds of affection and a community of care. And when I think about that, that like it makes me yes. well up, because it just, it's so heart-based. It's recognizing, like what you were even saying, it's recognizing the divinity and the sacredness in all of us, and then just operating from that place. And how do we actually support each other in the best way that we can bring each other's gifts and creativity into manifestation?
You know, we have a few family members visiting, and just last night we were having dinner together, and they were reminiscing about when they were young. So my dad is 75 years old, and my mom's aunt, who is here as well, is around the same age as well. And they were talking about what things were like when they were really little. And they started to talk about, you know, we didn't have refrigerators yet. And it was just, there was a company in the city that you basically went to, and you bought these slabs of ice, and they were thick and long. And that was basically how you stored food. And as they were talking about and reminiscing about the different things that they had to do as children to participate and as a community to get together, they were both so, like, my great aunt was so elated, and yeah. my dad was starting to tear up, and he says, you know, it's touching my heart. I feel like it was such a beautiful time. And I feel like in a lot of ways, when these systems that we've been so intertwined with start to come undone, then it's going to catapult us to a completely different way of being, unknown to us, probably even very different from what it is that they were talking about. But the difference being that it is going to return all of us to a system of care, or caring for one another, tending to one another, checking in on one another. And I'm really excited for that.
Yeah, it's going to be, and you know, there is that transitory time. Like, I do see, you know, we do need money, but you're right. It's like when that integrity and that heart space is open, it feels so good. And then that's just the gift, but it can be any kind of gift that gives back, right? It can be anything, but eventually it's like, you know, when we were originally there, that just didn't even exist, because we were so heart-centered. That, but there will be a transitory time, you know, like there's going to be several years where there'll be quick stages of evolution that we go through. And then we're going to land on 2 feet where we're back to that wholesomeness, where it's just literally, you know, the gift that keeps giving, which is the gift of, you know, the heart and the gift of, pure intention. So it's a really, like, I'll say it again, it's tremendous time of opportunity for all of us. And there's nothing to be afraid of. You know, when you really click back into your heart, there is nothing to fear. There's only opportunity. There's only opportunity.
I was going to ask you, do you have any final words of advice or anything that people can start to do or implement today as we kind of shift into a higher timeline?
So don't be afraid to face yourself. Don't be afraid. It's what I said a little bit earlier, but I'll say it again. Just be with yourself right now. Feel it all. And then also remember, that is not you. Any of that pain, that heaviness, that weight that you're feeling, that is not you in your origination. So you got to feel it to know it, to transcend it. So feel it all, and then put your foot down and say, now I want to know who I've always been. I want to know myself in my highest and just let it be. And then that starts the process, like the engine starts running. And don't be afraid. There's nothing to be afraid of. It's grand. It's just grand. So, and it's not without its challenges, but look, life is challenging. Why not get to know yourself in your highest through the challenges? Because you're going to be challenged anyways. We're going to be really challenged. So why not do it in the trajectory of self-care and self-knowing and oneness? Move in that trajectory with the challenges, as opposed to the challenges which separate you. You know, there's one or the other timeline right now is what I'm seeing. There's going to be one that separates you further, or there's going to be one that brings you in tighter. Choose the timeline that brings you in tighter to who you've always been, that highest, that innocence. Go there.
Beautiful. Thank you.
Kaya, where can people learn more about the work that you're doing and the music that you've got? And also for everybody here, keep holding on here, because at the end of all of this, we're going to play a piece for you that you'll be able to finish this off with. But where can people learn more about your work, Kaya?
I think the best place is just my website, thesimplicityplatform.com. We've got so much there. So my music, we've got a community in Mighty Networks, which is great. We come together every day and we do something called harmonic resonance. It's probably like what Oracle Girl does is what I'm feeling. It's just frequency. It's like I strike a frequency and then everyone comes together and we harmonize. So the website has the books, it has the music, it has everything. So, and if you've got any more questions, I've got a beautiful team who will answer any of your questions, but I'm here for you. I'm just here in every way and I'm excited. And, you know, it's time. It's just time.
Well, it's wonderful being on this journey with you, Kaya. We appreciate it. And I've loved getting to know you over this past year and a half. And
you guys are amazing. You guys are really amazing too. And I have to say, I love what you're doing because you're doing it. You're doing it. So that's what I say to people. Like when I can see they're doing it, you're doing it. So that is amazing. And like you're doing the follow through, you're doing it all. So thank you for the honor of being here with you and for me being able to witness a beautiful couple, and you're doing it together, which is even more powerful. It's beautiful to see that.
Thank you. To you too, Kaya. Mm-hmm. And everybody sit back and just enjoy this beautiful music and see where it lands for you. If you can, I think sit back and quiet and just take it in. Mm-hmm. Thank you.
begins.